Hey, it's Jordan with Status Quo, and I'm here with Leslie Johnson. You are a senior at Penn State University, and I messaged you because, honestly, it's kind of a credit to you and more of a just sad reflection of the state of journalism, but I saw from you, a student, more journalistic challenging of Beto O'Rourke than I have from any journalists covering the campaign. So Beto kind of surprisingly came to Penn State, I believe it was 2 days ago, and he was doing his thing where he stands on desks and bars and all this to...
He was on the stage this time, so that's an improvement at least.
Okay, so he was on stage and he was giving, quite a few, in your words, platitudes. So you got a question in. Let me just play that for the viewers.
¿Qué tal, Beto?
Mucho gusto. Es un placer estar aquí con ustedes. Gracias.
Gracias. So my question has to deal with campaign finance. You recently pulled in $6.1 million, if I occur... come on, give him a round of applause for that. It's not bad. It's not bad. You broke all records, which I guess is pretty good. But my concern is how much of that is coming from a process which is called bundling. For those of you who don't know, bundling is a process in which political activists and people in the private sector and lobbyists go to wealthy multimillionaires and billionaires and basically tell them to give the maximum, which is normally anywhere from $2,700 to $5,600, and basically use it to sort of overinflate a campaigner's, their first day totals. For example, just 1,000 people giving the maximum $5,600, that's $5.6 million right off the bat. Your campaign has not released the number of individual donors you have, nor has it released the average donation. Now, I'm not accusing you of that, but the fact that your campaign is currently working with notorious mega bundler Lewis Sussman gives me a bit of a clue. In addition, when we look on your website, we don't really see anything in terms of a solid platform for policies. It's mostly just platitudes and a merch store. So I guess, two-pronged question. One, are you going to...
please allow her to ask a question.
Yeah, so two-pronged question, I guess. One, are you going to release the number of individual donors and their average donor donation? Because I know your campaign has that data. If it didn't, it would mean you'd be running a very incompetent campaign, and I don't think you are. You seem like you have your stuff together, mostly. And two, when are we going to get an actual policy from you instead of just, like, platitudes and nice stories?
Yeah. Thank you. So the answer to your first question is yes. In addition to how much we raised, the fact that we raised it from all 50 states, the fact that we took not a dime from a single PAC or lobbyist, we will release the average and the number of donors. To your second question,
when?
To your second question about policy, I'm going to try to be as specific as I can. I mentioned our criminal justice system. I've called for the end of the prohibition on marijuana and the expungement of the arrest records of everyone who's been arrested for marijuana. I've been doing that for a long time. On the question of healthcare, you talked about universal guaranteed high quality healthcare. You asked the path to get there. Two extraordinary women with whom I've served in Congress, Jan Schakowsky of Illinois, Rosa DeLauro of Connecticut, have introduced a proposal called Medicare for America that ensures that if you have employer-based insurance and you like it, you keep it. Your doctors, your network, what works for you right now. If you don't have insurance or you don't like the insurance you already have, you enroll in Medicare. Costs a lot of money, it will be measured in the trillions of dollars. It is not inexpensive. As I made the point, and I hope the case earlier, it's a lot less expensive than taking care of people at end of life who've never been treated in the first place. When it comes to public school education, paying teachers a living wage and starting public education not in kindergarten at 5 years old, but in pre-K at 4 years old, university for every single child in the country. I was asked about the Green New Deal. I answered the question. question about the Green New Deal. When I talk about rural America, I talk about an opioid crisis which is disproportionately felt in rural America. I talk about those whom we must hold accountable for the crisis and the way in which we must treat those who are enduring the crisis, not through incarceration, but through compassion and treatment and care so that they can get back up on their feet. So in every single policy area, I'm trying to describe not just the goal and the aspiration, but the path that we will take to get there. I understand if we disagree or come to different conclusions. That's the genius of our democracy. I appreciate you being here and asking the questions. Thank you.
So, wow, you basically channeled what I would say. First of all, are you studying political science? How did you know that about bundlers and all that information?
So I am actually not a political science major. I study biology with a focus in genetics and evolutionary biology. I'm just really into politics. So I had seen the headline that came out a couple of days beforehand that he raised $6.1 million. And I was like, wow, that's a lot. I wonder how many people he had donated to him. And then I realized that hadn't been like released. So I did some digging and I found out about the bundling process, which before asking this question, I actually didn't know was a thing that went on. So I read up on it, got myself prepared, and then just got lucky enough to be given the mic and asked some questions.
So since the video was recorded before he gave out more of the information, I should say he came out today saying 128,000 people had donated at $47 a pop, yep. Which by my math, he is almost 100,000 less donors than Bernie Sanders had in the first 24 hours and $20 average. So $47 a pop, I'm not a mathematician, but that's probably a lot more max donations than Bernie Sanders received, which would indicate, like you said, bundlers. And you had pointed out a gentleman by the name of Louis Sussman, who was a big, big bundler who raised a lot of money for then candidate Obama's campaign. How'd you know about Mr. Sussman, and do you have concerns that a big financial hedge fund guy seems to be one of the key players behind Beto raising money?
Well, I found out about Mr. Sussman's involvement with the O'Rourke campaign through my background research that I did before sort of like deciding, all right, I'm going to go to the rally and I'm going to see if I can get this question answered in person. And I definitely have concerns, especially since he seems to have changed a lot of his policy positions. Like beforehand, when he was running against Ted Cruz, he said, okay, I'm not going to take any big oil and gas money. Turns out he ended up taking quite a bit. He was initially for Medicare for All. Now he's toting this Medicare for America thing, which is basically a subpar sort of half public option while keeping a lot of the private insurance industry infrastructure intact. So all that just kind of gave me pause. So definitely the involvement of anyone who's big on Wall Street with a presidential campaign is something I am not about at all.
You know, it's interesting to me because, I mean, you don't have to be into politics to say he's charismatic. I mean, he's like, we've seen him standing on bars and on desks and on whatever he could find. And he waves around his hands and talks in, you know, I don't care what religion you are, sex you are, what you blah, 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 blah. And he kind of, I think even he has said, I could be whatever you want me to be, or said something like that, which troubles me a little bit because A, I do this for a living. So, you know, policy is important. But B, it seems like that would be a message for a lot of young people in college that aren't read up on the policies, that aren't read up on the policy change, and just are enamored by his personality. Did you see any of that among your colleagues at Penn State?
I definitely saw some of it. I got some very nasty looks after sort of killing the vibe a bit and asking those questions. But yeah, there was definitely some people who were like cheering a lot about what he had to say. And it's great to like say you support those things, but if you don't back it up with specific policy ideas, specific plans, and specific legislation, it's just sort of like, you're not really doing much. You're paying lip service to all these great ideas, but if you're not going to put your skin in the game and actually work on it, it doesn't mean much of anything.
Right. And I mean, I'm sure you're not sitting watching CNN all day. I hope not, for your health. But no.
I can't afford cable.
Oh, well, there you go. But also, well, you can watch Status Quo for free. But I wanted to ask you, because it seems to me I don't really see any journalists bringing up or asking him, like, in 2012, he was for means testing Social Security. He had critical comments towards labor unions when he was on El Paso's city council. He was also involved in essentially kind of bulldozing a community, the El Barrio community. I mean, there's a lot of there's a lot of stuff where you could read what he said or listen to what he said back in the early 2010s. And if you don't know it's him, it's can kind of sound like Mitt Romney. So what do you think about, as far as, I mean, I know you only saw him at one rally, but are you seeing enough critical media coverage? Because to me, when I was, I feel really old saying this, but when I was your age, 21, it was Obama, 2007. And I was getting hoodwinked back then myself. I was part of that. So it kind of has kind of similar patterns to that, where people are just getting so caught up in this optimism and not really looking under the hood.
Yeah, I definitely don't think there's nearly enough critical media coverage of any of these presidential campaigns, let alone like politicians in general. And I think it's because two reasons. One is because a lot of these journalistic outlets are afraid of losing access and afraid of losing these like privileged sort of meetings that they can get, so they can be the first to break the story and get these exclusive one-on-ones. And the second, I think, is definitely from like a class interest perspective. Like, they support people who are going to uphold the interests of their class, which are generally wealthier. And the same people that are working on Wall Street are the same people that watch CNN and own CNN and are the same people who are really interested in making sure that a presidential campaign doesn't do stuff like Medicare for All and doesn't raise taxes on the rich. So I think it's sort of like a two-pronged issue.
And let me ask you, because unless I missed it, I didn't actually see his answer to you. I just saw your question. What did he say when you said, do you have anything other than platitudes? And what did he tell you?
Well, he went in on, he said, he talked about a little more about his Medicare for America thing and how he had two of his colleagues who are writing it, two colleagues who, by the way, take a lot of PAC money, and a little bit more about how he wants to legalize marijuana and a few other things that were sort of pandery for a college age audience. But in terms of like, I want to support this bill, I want to do this thing, I want to add my weight behind this specific piece of legislation, or this group has brought this issue to me, there's really not a lot there.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting, because you might not know this, because I don't think a lot of people do. When he was in the Texas primary against Seema Hernandez, was his opponent, when it was clear that he was going to win the primary, they met privately. And according to her, I wasn't there, but I could go by what she says, he, in trying to get her support and endorsement and get her voters, said, if I was elected to the Senate, I would support Medicare for All. This was less than a year ago, so how do you change less than a year ago, I'm going to support Medicare for All as a senator, to now running for office with polls showing 70% of people favor it, now suddenly you're not for it? Do you have concerns that that's dictated by the people donating to him?
I think it's partially dictated by the donors and partially dictated by the people who he may have advising him when he's running this campaign, because I've seen a definite pivot to the center from him. And I think it's because he's got a lot of these same like establishment types that are like, don't go too far to the left, don't go too far to the left, you don't want to alienate the mom in Kansas or stuff like that, and stuff that we've been told, but the polls and the statistics don't really appear to be true.
Mm-hmm. And I'd like to ask you, CNN is out with a poll. I looked at the poll. I went through the poll. Their methodology is absurd. It honestly doesn't even release.
I know what poll you're talking about. Yeah.
It doesn't even, I don't even think they polled more than 125 millennials, but they used that as a headline and a narrative that Bernie Sanders is losing support across the board. Obviously, you're only one millennial, but are you seeing enthusiasm among your student body for Bernie Sanders, or is something happening that people all of a sudden don't support him?
I mean, between all of my friends and my sort of like activist colleagues, Bernie is definitely the front runner. Like, I've got a couple people who really like Elizabeth Warren as well, and she's got some stuff that I really enjoy. I feel like the other day at her town hall, she was talking about getting an amendment to make sure that everybody is able to vote and that we really enshrine the right to vote in our Constitution, and I really like that. But for most young people that I'm seeing, it's Bernie's definitely the front runner.
Mm. And what about you? Tell me about where you're from. What are you passionate about politically? And, you know, most people don't do the research on politics. So is there particular issues that are driving your passion?
Well, I identify as a socialist. So I am for the public ownership of the means of production, as opposed to private ownership of the means of production, and doing that through an equitable redistribution of wealth and an intersectional promotion of workers' rights. So it sort of all sort of really ties together for me, because I'm an evolutionary biologist. So I feel like if we want to move forward as a species, we really need to utilize everybody, and the current economic system that we're having is not the most efficient way that we can help the most people and make sure that we have the most intellectual power being contributed to the advancement of the human race and the protection of our planet. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of where I'm coming from on that.
How do your parents feel about that?
Well, they're okay with it. I mean, growing up, my parents, they're like Dems, but they don't talk about politics much, but I suspect they're more liberal than I used to think they are. Like, mm-hmm. My mom back in like the 70s was like a big like anti-Vietnam War protester, and they've always sort of been like in that vein, but they didn't really talk to me much about politics because they wanted me to form my own opinions. Mm-hmm. So yeah, they're pretty much okay with it. Some of them, they may think, oh, that's never gonna happen. Like, I remember my dad vividly telling me, oh, Medicare for all, single payer healthcare, that's never gonna happen in the United States. Mm-hmm. Fast forward a couple years later, it's getting more and more popular. So parents aren't always right about everything.
Right, and can you kind of talk about, you were getting heat from other students in the crowd that you kind of challenged him. Why is that? Because they don't care about his record, or they just thought it was uncomfortable? I'm just curious, why wouldn't more young people want him to answer for evolutions in his record?
I feel like they, part of it was sort of making people uncomfortable. And I think another part of it was kind of like, I burst sort of the Beto bubble that was in the, because it's like, oh yeah, because before, like, everyone was really pretty much feeling his vibe. Like, he was talking a great talk. As you said, he's very charismatic, and he had taken a few other questions beforehand, like, what are you going to do for the LGBTQ community and stuff like that, which I thought he gave really good answers to. But I think kind of bringing in some critical thinking in there, it maybe wasn't what people signed up for when they decided to go to a political rally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, most of the looks I got were from people who were in the crowd who were older, because it wasn't just students there, it was a lot of people from our town as well.
That I'm not shocked by, because I've seen I've seen those same looks at me.
Yeah.
lastly, so I think the media is basically kind of passing on the baton here and there. So at first they were really trying to push Kamala Harris strongly, then she was kind of stagnant, so then they start, now they're pushing Beto. I think when Biden comes in, I think there's really a strategy, anybody but Bernie, among most media outlets. What do you think in terms of I think that a lot of millennials, if this is an unfair process to Bernie Sanders after 2016, I think there's a real fear that a lot of millennials would stay home against Donald Trump, even though, you know, he's terrible. We all acknowledge that. If this is not a fair process, do you see already concerns, not just the media, but basically among the national party, as far as keeping this an even playing field?
Well, I'd say right now, with how the things have been treating Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, Tulsi Gabbard, basically any sort of more progressive candidates. It's definitely not an even playing field from like a party side or a media side. But again, I think for a lot of people who are in power, whether it's in media or in big business or even in politics, they don't hate the idea of a second Trump presidency as much as they want you to think. And the reason why is because Trump's economic policies are very beneficial to him. He's giving tax cuts to the rich. He's deregulating a lot of industries that helps line their pockets. So as a result, they can sort of set their morals aside for the sake of making more money.
Couldn't agree more. Now, I'm just going to let you know, I would say the biology field can use you. But if that doesn't work out, I would definitely stay in touch with B because you would be a badass journalist. There's not enough. I'm not trying to lecture because I'm not like I'm not that much older. But a lot too many young people get kind of bogged down in charisma. And I think what Bernie is showing you, there's a whole lot more young people that are feeling the effects as far as climate change, lack of health care, student debt, you name it. So I'm hoping that there's more of those kinds of young people than the people kind of buying into, in my view, the Beto bullshit. So thank you and keep on researching and doing great things. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Jordan. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.
Hope you enjoyed that last video. Hop on over to statuscoup.com where you can sign up for our email list and become a member for as low as $5 to $10 a month. Membership is how we grow. That's statuscoup.com/join. And remember, join our email list so we can grow the revolution with you.